Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. This is, of course, the last Wednesday of not only the month of December, but the entire year of 2021. And so we will hear from another one of our magnificent ministers here at Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church. And today, our preacher is none other than Dr. Natalina Tolbert. I will officially read some of her bio to present her to some and maybe even introduce her to others. Minister Dr. Natalina Rogers Tolbert is the youngest daughter of the late Reverend Amos and Clara Rogers of Cross, South Carolina, where her parents were community activists and worked diligently in the local schools and churches. After the tragic death of her mother and sister, Adelaide, the community embraced Natalina with open arms and rallied to the aid of her widowed father to help raise her. It is that reason she grew up living the old African adage that it takes a village to raise a child, and as a result, became a worker for Christ at an early age. After leaving St. John Baptist Church in Sumter, South Carolina, where her maternal grandfather was the founder and former pastor at Mount Nebo United Methodist Church, she became a member of Silas United Methodist Church, where her father was the pastor for 20 years. While at Silas, she continued to be involved in and lead many ministries to blossom into the woman of God she is today. Currently, Dr. Tolbert is a member, of course, of our wonderful church and is involved in many ministries, including the clergy, the Baptist Young Women, missionary, Sunday school, oratorical, youth ministry, morning prayer line, upper room prayer, small group studies, Bible study, Jubilee choir, sanctuary choir, and Boy Scouts. Minister Tolbert is married to Mr. Barrett Tolbert, and they have two sons, Daniel and Joshua, and she enjoys ministering, listening to music, singing, performances, traveling, spending time with her family, friends, and loved ones. And it is at this time, after our meditation moment, that we will hear from none other than this great woman of God. And so, take a moment in center as we prepare to hear a word from the Lord.
Moriah, this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is just an honor to be here to share the word with you, and I would like to thank our wonderful pastor, Pastor Benton, and also acknowledge our Pastor Emeritus Robinson, our Mount Moriah Church family, all spiritual leaders, family, and friends. I personally would like to thank you for your support that you have shown me as I have grown in Jesus Christ. Thank you so much. Today's scripture will be coming from Romans, the 8th chapter, starting at the 18th verse, going to the 19th verse, and then we will pick up at the 28th verse through the 30th. 18th verse, I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy of comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. 28th verse. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he has predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he glorified. God bless the hearers and the doers of his word. Let us pray. Father, we thank you right now for this moment. We invite you into this sermon. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable unto you, O Lord, as my rock and my redeemer. Amen. According to Zondervan Bible Commentary, Romans 8 reminds us that God is busy recreating this world and that those of us who are united with Christ by faith are being transformed. And the church is being transformed as God's pilot unit for what the world should look like. And the commentary's view is that Romans 8 describes how God is at work in a suffering world. We know he has identified with this world through his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, suffered for all of our sins, and participated with us in the suffering of this world. We know he is with us in our suffering. It doesn't solve the problem at the philosophical level. No, it doesn't. The problem of how God can be all powerful and all good, and yet good people can suffer. How can that be? It doesn't solve the problem for us. He's transforming the church. And eventually, he'll transform this whole world to bring suffering and oppression to the end. You see, these past few months have turned into an interesting year for me. My life experiences have left me with the point of view that life is like mathematics. Mathematics, yes, you see, some days we live life prosperously. It feels like we are adding more joy, more peace, and more happiness. We praise God more than the norm for our health and strength. And as soon as there's an abundance of addition of praise and worship, a challenge seems to come. And it appears that life is being sucked out of us. And all of a sudden, it creates a substitution equation. And there are those days of multiplication moments when God blesses us exceedingly and abundantly, far greater than what we ever can imagine. Life seems to be overflowing with blessings and miracles. Then the days go by and we may feel the pressures of life, the negative spirits of this world, chaos, lies, deceits, to try to divide our mindsets, divide our world, and divide our families. Now, you see, those are just the fundamental days of mathematics. Mathematicians know that there are some complex equations and problems that need to be worked out step by step in order for them to be solved. And for us, we may experience these as those moments of complexities where mere words cannot express our experiences. Things of life become too complex, too compound, and too complicated, so we tend to request a tutor. It's like we seek help. So today I want you to think about our topic, or our title is, God is greater than. God is greater than. As I looked more into this math topic, I discovered some information about inequalities. We may feel familiar with the word inequality to mean the phenomenon of equal or and or unjust distribution of resources and opportunities among members of a given society, the partiality, injustice, and unevenness. And in the world of math, an inequality compares two values, showing if one is less than, greater than, or simply not equal to another value. In the mathematical writing, the greater than sign is typically placed between two values being compared, and it indicates that the first number is greater than the second number. Now, inequalities can be tricky, but no matter how tricky they are, when I think about inequalities, I always remember that God is greater. In today's text, it reminds us that all things work together for our good. This entire passage in Romans is really helpful for understanding what suffering is all about, especially as Christians. And I want you to take away three tips for working with inequalities of life. Tip number one, God is all-knowing. Inequalities can be a difficult concept to get a handle on, especially the greater than and less than signs. They kind of look similar, but these symbols are very useful because they help us to show the relationship between numbers or equations in a way that does not just say that they are not equal. One number is less than, and one number is greater than. When I heard the word relationship, it automatically reminded me that God wants us to have a relationship with Him. We are His children, and He is our Father. As a good father, He provides and protects His children. He is our Creator. He designed everything. That includes us. He desires to be with us all. He loves none more than the other. I'm sorry. And He wants us all to come to Him and allow Jesus to be our Lord and Savior. God is greater than, and God is all-knowing. Romans 8:29 through 30 tells us that for those He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. Foreknew means already knew about the event prior to it happening. Predestined means life was determined in advance by divine will or fate. So let's take for example, God must have something special or something intimate in mind when He was speaking to Jeremiah when He said, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Jeremiah 1:5. You see, God is all-knowing. Since inequalities can be a difficult concept, how can we remember greater than versus less than signs? One easy strategy is the alligator method. This is when you imagine them as little alligators with the numbers on either side representing a fish. The alligator always wants to eat the larger number of the fish. So whatever number the mouth is open toward is the larger fish. So this alligator reminds me of God. No matter the size of the problem, big or small, He can demolish them all. God is greater than big. God is greater than small. God is greater than us all. God is just greater than. So when you think about inequalities, we must remember that God is God, and we are not equal to Him. He is greater than us. He is greater than Satan. He is greater than all things. When we remind ourselves of the symbol that God is greater than, we can rest in knowing that he is already handling the problem. He knows the full situation. He knows how the problem was created, and he knows the solution. He is our Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. So therefore, even if he's a complex concept, he already can be applied to any equation of life. He is just greater than. Now, moving on to our second tip of inequalities of life. Remember that God is committed to all of his children. Yes, inequality reminds us to keep in mind that as we are working on inequalities, they're typically asking us for a relationship or identify which symbol is appropriate rather than asking us to solve a single number. Well, that tells me that God is not asking me to figure out anything. He is not asking me to be God. He just wants me to be his child. He just wants me to know that he is committed to taking care of me as his daughter. When I keep professing and keep believing that he is my father, I will see his work at hand. Basically, with inequalities, it is like God answering us yes or no. One does not have to work out anything. I just have to wait on God to tell me yes or no. Well, some of us say, why didn't she really say wait? Well, if you think about it, while we are waiting, we are professing that God is committed to us and that he is greater than any other situation. Now, if we keep waiting and praising him, eventually the answer will be yes or no. We must learn to trust and believe God that he will do what he said he would do. God said he predestined us for greatness, so when we are weak, he is committed to helping us go through our challenges. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He is committed to keeping his children. Romans 8:26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what should we pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with the groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he can search the hearts and knows the minds of the Spirit, because he makes intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. God is committed to us, that he even made provision for us to have the Holy Spirit to look after us. No matter what, the mission is accomplished because God is working things out for the good. Now, you see, the second half of that tip mentions that when working out inequalities, they are typically asking us to identify which symbol is appropriate, rather than asking us to solve for a single number. I love to say, to God be the glory, because I need to recognize a symbol as well. So I will identify the symbol of the cross. I identify with Jesus's blood is greater than anything. Jesus's blood is greater than my sins. Jesus' blood already has paid the price for me. So I can recognize the cross as the appropriate symbol for my life. I do not need to solve life's problem in my strength. I just need to pray to God, pray to my big brother Jesus, my advocate, my deliverer, my savior, my joy, my peace, my healer, my love, my joy, my waymaker, my rock, my redeemer, and my wonderful counselor. You see, he is my everything. No matter what the experience in life is, God is greater than. And now, getting down to our third tip, God is trustworthy with all of his promises. When it comes to inequalities, one does not need to end up with two numbers on either side of an equal sign to be right. The answer just needs to be true. Ha, wow, doesn't math sound like the characteristics of God? As human beings, we do not have the right in our own strength. We just have to be right with God. The answer is always truth. Well, what is the answer to all of our problems? The truth, Jesus. We must be right in knowing who Jesus is and what his word says about salvation. We must trust in his word and that his word is true. So here are some truths about God's word. Number one, God loves you. 1 John 4:9. This is how God shows us his love among us. He sent his one and only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. Truth number two. Truth is God created you for a special purpose. The famous Jeremiah 29:11 reminds us that, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future." Truth is, God wants the best for you. Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Truth is, God's timing is perfect. 1 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. The truth is, God will provide all of your needs according to his great riches and glory in heaven. Philippians 4:19. The truth is, God is faithful. Deuteronomy 7:9. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps his covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. Hallelujah. The truth is God is greater than. Now I know you've heard some sermons or some songs about God is greater, but I want you to put a name on the inequalities of life. So when you get the answer, when you get the cry, when the situation and circumstances are being heard by the Father, are being answered by the Father, you can continue to shout hallelujah, because God is greater than. He is no match for the situation or the circumstance. He is like the alligator in the inequality problem. He is greater than any equation and can demolish any snare, any scheme of the enemy. God is greater than any mountain of discouragements, headaches, pains, any disappointments, discouragements, frustration, COVID-19, cancer, diabetes, PTSD, anemia, any other sicknesses or disease. God is greater than the family and friends issues of discord, disagreements, affairs, divorce, grief, loss, abuse, bitterness, jealousy, chaos, and just plain old mess. God is greater than even the church's issues. So who wants to be in charge and who wants to think they're being in charge? The gossip, the exclusions, the mistreatments, the lies, and the deceit. God is greater than our community issues of injustices, inequality, incarceration. He's greater than those politicians, legislators, civic groups, judges, lawyers, and any leader in any type of position. God is even greater than your financial issues of not being paid or being laid off, unemployed, low wages, no wages, looking for a job and can't find one. Student bills, student loans, financial strongholds. No matter what God chooses for us to go through in having discomfort in this life, we must put a name on it and know that God is greater than. Now, when we put a name on it, remember that we are being specific. And when we put a name on it, remember we choose to believe that God is greater than. And you fill in that blank. So when you choose to believe in his word, we have to choose that in spite of what we may see and what we may hear and what we experience, he is working things out for the good because he loves us and we are still called according to his purpose. God is greater than anything negative that tries to come in our lives. We must choose to believe that God still loves us, even when our family and our friends walk out on us and they don't understand what God is doing. He is greater than the rejection. We must choose to believe that God is greater than our children's disobedience. He is greater than their choices. We must choose to believe that when our spouses doesn't do what he or she should do to sustain a marriage, that God is greater than the unwilling spirit. We must choose to believe after leaving an abusive relationship that God can catapult us into better situations because he's bigger and greater than the abuse. We must choose to believe that when we are living a single life, God is still our keeper and he is in our current situations. We must choose to believe that as our Jehovah Jireh, when we have bills that are overflowing and when we don't have enough to cover it, God will supply all of our needs according to his great riches and glory. He is greater than our bill. We must choose to believe that he is even greater at work, that when they start planning and plotting against us, God is greater than leadership and gossip. We must choose to believe that when we are not making the grades in school, that God is greater than our failures. And we must also choose to believe when life happens and despite the unwanted pregnancy, God's love still reigns and there is greater in that pregnancy. We must choose to believe that when we want to quit and give up, God will show up. He is greater than our feelings and our thoughts. We must choose to believe that even when we become of age and our insurance coverage changes, he is greater than that coverage. We must also choose to believe that when we cannot physically get around like how we want to get around, God will uphold us and he is greater than our physical state. We must choose to believe that when we become of age and our children seem to forget about us, we have to remember to cast all of our cares on the Lord, and he is greater than that abandonment. We must choose to believe that when we articulate our thoughts and our feelings, our needs, that God will provide. He is even greater than ourselves. And when it comes time for you to jump into action to say or do what the Spirit is leading you to do, we must trust and believe God that he is greater than anything and that he has already gone before us and he's working it out on our behalf like he did Moses when the Israelites were mad at Moses, like he did for Rahab when she needed to escape from her homeland, just like he did for Peter and Paul when they were released from jail. God is always working things out because God is greater than what any eyes have seen or any ears have heard. God is greater than what we are feeling. God is greater than this, and God is greater than that. God has sent his only begotten Son, and that so whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Also, God gave authority of heaven and earth to Jesus. And because Jesus has the power and the authority on earth, and when we give our hearts and our lives to him, we have a victorious life. Jesus is the one that was appointed by God to come to earth for us. Because he loved us so. Jesus is the one that experienced the hardships of life so we can be forgiven. Jesus is the one that was beaten, went to Calvary, died on the cross for our sins. Jesus is the one that stayed in the tomb for 3 days and 3 nights and arose from the grave. Jesus is the one that still lives today, and he lives in you and he lives in me. So Jesus commands us to go out into this world for his honor and for his glory. He sends us knowing we will be hated and will be faced with trials and tribulations and temptations. But be assured, he assures us that we are ultimate victory is already secure because he himself lives in us. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. Remember, God is all-knowing, God is committed, God is trustworthy. So as you are facing your challenges, your circumstances, and your inequalities of life, remember, God is greater than, God is greater than this, and God is greater than that. God is greater than. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I pray that this message was a blessing to you. And as you tuned in and as the Spirit moved on your heart, maybe you are one who needs to receive Jesus today as your personal Lord and Savior. The best time to give your life to Christ is right now. The best time to rededicate your life is right now. And so my brother, my sister, I want to invite you to say this prayer with me. If you'd like to give your life or rededicate your life to Jesus, let us pray. Father, say, Father, I am a sinner and I confess today with my mouth and believe with my heart that Jesus the Christ is Lord and Savior of my life. Say, today I am changed. Today I am transformed. Today is a new day and God is getting the glory. Father, I pray now for that one who has surrendered all to you today and pray that they would connect with a church where they can grow in you. Bless them now with increase in all the things that would help them to live a life that glorifies your name. We pray for all those who have tuned in today. Be a great blessing to them, O God. Keep them and help them, shape them and mold them, that, Lord, your glory would be revealed. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. I want to thank you for tuning in today, for making this Bible study time a sacred time set apart for your own growth and development. And I look forward to seeing you soon. God bless you.